Welcome back to Dawn and Friends. Let's get back to our visit with 103-year-old Marie Rainwater.
Well, I would say it's this dope. This dope is, I tell you, this town, from what you read in the paper, I'd never known anybody that used dope. But I read it in the paper and I think, and then another thing is this suicide of these young people. I feel like the town failed those people. There's something wrong. Either they didn't, I'm not going to blame the parents, but it seemed to me if the parents had brought them up in an atmosphere that had given them hope and helped them get to go to college and things like that. Now, not everybody wants to go to college, and I say let them go to tech school, but they all need advanced learning for a trade or for a profession, and they get being an adult so they can take care of themselves and make a living. And then another thing that I'm sick about is if these big companies don't pay people a decent wage. I'm for that. And then the other thing that I've always been ever since I've been growing up, I take up for women. Women ought to be paid the same pay that the men did. And I was always paid at least $500 less than a man. And I never could understand why. And I asked one, and he said, it's because we keep the discipline. And I thought, oh, shoot. About that time, a kid ran in, they were having riots. And he said, there's a boy out there, and he's wanting to fight. The kids are all going to fight him. And so I said to this man, aren't you going out? And he said, no, I'm not going out. Let them settle it. Well, I got up and went out, and I told that boy to leave the campus. I said, you don't belong here. And then I told the students, it was about 10 minutes before they had to go in for the bell, I said, all of you go in, go to your classroom. And the kids all marched in and went in and sat down. And I went back and I said to this man, where is the discipline from men? And so when the principal came, after lunch, while he called me in, and he said, Mrs. Rainwater, I don't want you ever to go out on that campus to try to save a riot or something. Said, you could have been stabbed or shot or something. Said, you don't know what you got to do. Said, just call the police. That's what they're for. But it's such a difference now in teacher school, but I still think that I could go up to that high school. Someone's having trouble with their students, and I can go in there and I talk, and for some known reason, I have ability that people will listen to me. And while you're talking, they're pulling it in and thinking it over, and it may help them, and then give them hope. And then I think what is wrong with the churches, why they're losing membership, is because of the members who claim to be such Christian people, and in your dealings with them, you cannot say that it's such Christian behavior. And I think that has really damaged the churches in the United States, is the people that live supposedly a Christian life just don't measure up. Well, the way I look at it this way, that I was allowed to, the Lord gave me that 100 years to live. And when I got there, I've been granted another year, and on and on. And then one thing about it, I had a painting class with a Jewish woman once, and when I'd drop a brush and wouldn't get any paint on the floor, I'd say, thank God. And here the other day, I read quite an article about it said that you should thank God for the things you've done. Well, see, I've had cancer. The first cancer scare was they wanted to amputate my leg. And I know it was a prayer of my students, and there's one church here in town held a prayer vigil for me and all, and it turned out to be a fatty tumor. I went to Temple, Texas and had the operation. Then the second time I had it, Loretta's a little girl about the fourth grade. We went to Temple. I drove the car myself, and I went through the clinic again. I was going to sleep, and I gained a lot of weight, and I had thyroid cancer. And so they operated and took the thyroid all out, and I've never had any more trouble with it. Well, then it went on about 10 years, and then I found a lump in my breast. And so it was cancer of the breast, and I had Dr. Renee, what's her name now? I can't think of it, but it's Renee Bassett used to be. And so she operated on that, and I've never had another thing happen to us, and that's been 16 years ago. Well, I thought about that. You know, so many times God comes to our rescue and heals us, or may give us something that we've been praying for, and then do we ever thank Him? And I think you have to thank. And then another thing, I think it'd do everybody well if they would, just when they meet someone, smile or say hello to them. Or I get a conversation going with these kids that are waiting tables over at OSU. I ask them if they're going to OSU. Oh, yes, they are. They're proud of that. Well, what are you majoring in? I just keep on. And then the last thing I'll say, I knew by looking at your face that you're not dopey and you don't deal in alcohol. And I, young man or young lady, you stick to that till you graduate. Give them hope and give them encouragement. But so many people are down on that young people. They just can't give the young people a decent word. And the young people are our future, if we'd only look at it. It's our future. And this town's future. And so when I feel that some boy or girl has committed suicide, I think I wish I'd have talked to that young man or young lady before this happened. Because I don't care what's happened to you. You start in living a good life and have hopes and pray every day. And then you're going to feel better and you're going to prosper.
What a pleasure it was to spend some time with Marie Rainwater. Marie, thank you so much for letting me come into your home. And in the thoughts of Marie and back of yesteryear, we're going to listen to a 1937 tune of Woody Guthrie's titled Talking Dust Bowl Blues. I hope you enjoy it as much as I do. It's always been one of my favorite Woody songs. Let's check it out.
Back in 1927, I had a little farm and I called it heaven. Prices up and rain come down and I hauled my crops all into town. I got the money, bought clothes and groceries, fed the kids, took it easy. The rain it quit and the wind got high and the black old dust storms filled the sky. And I swapped my farm for a Ford machine and I filled it full of this gas I lean and started rolling and drifting to California. Way up up yonder on a mountain road. I had a hot motor and a heavy load. I was going pretty fast, I wasn't even stopping. I was bouncing up and down like popcorn a popping. Had a breakdown, sort of a nervous bust down of the mechanism there, some kind of engine trouble. Here's the way up yonder on the mountain road. I wasn't feeling so very good, and I give this rolling forward a shove, and I was gonna coast as fur as I could. Commenced rolling, picking up speed, and there was a hairpin turn, and I couldn't make it. Man alive, I'm telling you, the fiddles and the guitars really flew. That Ford took off like a flying squirrel, and it flew halfway around the world. Scattered wives and children all over the side of that mountain. Got to old Los Angeles broke, so that gum hungry we thought we'd choke, and I bummed up a spud or two, and my wife cooked up a tater stew. Fed the kids a big bait of it, but that was mighty thin stew. So that gum thin, you could pretty near read a magazine through it. If it had been just a little bit thinner, I've always believed that stew had been just a little bit thinner, some of our senators could have seen through it.
You're watching RDMG TV.